A warm welcome to all the participants in this webinar session on Tally Beginner's Essentials, Part 1 of 4, and we will be covering startup and basic essentials which are required as a beginner to learn Tally ERP 9. So, let us start with some of the prerequisites. So, what we mean by prerequisites is that we want to assure you that you do not require any prior knowledge of Tally. Of course, if you do know something, there will still be a lot to learn, and we will be covering some of the essence of Tally and the factors that make Tally such a loved product by lots of businesses. So, the first part of this session is one part of four sessions, and all of them will be focusing on Tally. So, hence, we will not be covering the basics of PCs, MS Windows, file folders, and parts, email, basic use of the internet, file downloads, etc. So this is what we mean by prerequisites. We are expecting that you would have a basic understanding of Windows and your system, your file folders, paths, email, internet, and also file downloads. So the basic configuration and basic setup, we hope that you would be already aware about this. So let us start with this session, and we will just cover what are the learning objectives of this session. So the first is installing Tally, license activation, company creation, ledger account, vouchers, bill by bill tracking, and financial reporting. So all of you can note down these objectives, and we will be taking each of them one by one so that we can understand and we can also see the same in the product and get a full knowledge of these topics. Let us start with the English fundamentals. So, what do we mean by English fundamentals that are required? These are features, capability, and benefits. So, if you see on the screen, now there is a handheld device, and you can see that it contains a fingerprint scanner. So, one person is scanning his fingerprint. So let us say that this is used by the government to distribute subsidies. So let us analyze and understand. So for this fingerprint scanner, what is the feature? Now the feature is very obvious. That is, the device has a fingerprint scanner. So the fingerprint scanner is a feature. Now what is its capability? So the capability is that it helps authenticate that the person who places his finger on the scanner. And thirdly, what are the benefits? The benefits of this are that the right person really gets the money and filtering due to misuse is greatly reduced. So these are some terms that you can actually keep in mind, and you can analyze as we move through the features of Tally, how we have provided the feature, what is the capability of the feature, and what are the benefits. So in this way, you can understand the complete meaning of our tagline, Power of Simplicity. So let us see with installing Tally. So we will start with the first topic, which is installing Tally. So now we will compare what are the features, capability, and benefits of installing Tally. So the feature is that we have a very small installer. Now you can see on the screen It is hardly a 30 MB file. Capability is that it is portable. So portable means you can carry it in even the smallest pen drive and it installs in 1 minute. What is the benefit? Benefit is that you can even download it from our website. You can quickly start using it, maybe in a half an hour if you are going for a demo. You can, in half an hour you can demonstrate the features and the customer can start using the product. System upgrades and reinstallation do not stop operation. So while the customer is working, you can simultaneously upgrade your system and you can simultaneously reinstall Tally and it will not stop its operation. So let us start with installing Tally. So we will see this with installing Tally from the website. Now the first thing that you have to decide when you are installing Tally from the website is whether you want to install the 32-bit installer or the 64-bit installer. Now 64-bit installer is for 64-bit operating system. So first of all, how can you understand whether your system is a 32-bit or 64-bit system? So for this, now we will move to the desktop. Now my system is a Windows 7 operating system. So you can see how we can understand in a Windows 7 operating system. Now in different operating systems, that is versions, Windows 7, Windows 8, there are different versions. So in different versions, you have different methods of understanding whether it is a 32-bit or a 64-bit installer. So now let us move to my desktop. I will go to my computer, I will right click and select properties. So I hope all of you are able to see this screen. Now I am on control panel and system. So I have gone to this screen by right clicking on computer and selecting properties. So when I select that, you will see your system type is 64-bit operating system. So in this way, you can understand whether the system is a 32-bit or 64-bit operating system. Now if it is a 64-bit operating system, it is suggested that you install 64-bit installer. But you can always install 32-bit installer also in a 64-bit system. Next step, you have to select whether you want to install with the reference manual, that is the help file, or without the reference manual. Now, reference manual is very helpful for the customer to always refer and get ready support for this small query. So, if only in a scenario where, say, installation or download of the installer is taking lot of time, so your internet connection is slow, only then it is recommended that you install the light installer, that is without the help file. Okay, so now before moving to second part of installation, let us actually start installing Tally from the website. So I will open Tally Solutions website. You have to click on download. Link to download center. So I hope all of you are able to see the screen. I am on download center and now I am going to install 64-bit installer. The full installer I am going to install. So I will click on it. It will ask me whether I want to run or save this file. So say I run the installer from here. So now the installer is getting downloaded. So while this installer is getting downloaded, I request all of you to do the same. Or if at all you have an installer, you can start installing. So as you can see, this download is almost finishing of the installer. So now we have to run the installer. So this is release 4.91 we have installed and this is the installation wizard. When we click next, it asks whether we want to install a single user or multi user. Single user is silver license and multi user is for gold license. And multi user is when you want to connect to a already existing license on the same LAN. So for now let us install as single user. Before we click next, let us move back to the presentation. So let us go to part 2 of 4. So first of all, now what we have done is we have just selected it as single user. So now for that there was no error message as shown on the screen. So you can see on the screen that an error message shown, which is insufficient permission to install Tally RP9. Now this error message comes only where the user does not have administrator rights. So if a user gets this error message, yeah, that person will have to shift to a user profile with her administrator rights. Next is single or multi-user. So as we have seen, I have selected single user. So this completes part 2 of 4. Now let us move to part 3. So in our installer also, we will move to this part. Okay, so we will click on next. Now this is a new installation. You can see here, new installation. Let us move to the presentation. Now here, if you see, it is running a new installation as well as upgradation. Now, the time when it's your upgradation, it means that in the part, that is in the application directory, in this part, there is already a version of Kali Ultimate installed. So if you are clicking upgradation and if you are giving the same path, you have to be very careful because sometimes the customer will want to use his previous version and he will not want to update his version to the latest release. Or what he might want is, he might want to see both the versions. So you might want to see one version in one part and the other version in the other part. So you have to consult the customer as install accordingly. So for us, we will install it as a new installation and I have given a path for application directory and data directory. So data directory is where your data will reside. So for now, these are directories and we will accept what Kali gives by default and we will click on next. So let us move back to the presentation. Now, part 4 is language support. So, if you want language support other than English, say Hindi or Tamil, any other languages, now this is related to Windows operating system language support. So, if it is already installed, for example, if it comes to our installer, it is already installed, so it is already in. But if it is not installed, you will need to install it. So, country, by default, it is selected as India. And startup language English and I will click on install. So it is installing. While it is installing, let us move to the presentation. Now presentation we saw is the language support. That is done. We have clicked on it. And now we will come to launching that. So let us move our installer now. So you can see the same screen which is launch Kali ERP9 here is shown in the presentation also. So now there are three ways to launch Kali. One is from here itself, that is right after installation. One is after installing Kali, there will be an icon on the desktop that is created, a shortcut. And also from Windows Start, like this, you can search for Kali ERP9 and you get launch Kali. So these are the three ways to launch Kali. So let us launch Kali from here. So I will click on finish. Okay, so we have come to the startup screen. Now this is the screen that you see when you launch Kali for the first time. So you can see activate license, reactivate license, buy rental license, configure existing license, login as remote Kali Net user and work in educational mode. So now we will be concentrating on activate license because activate license is the it comes when you have to activate it for the first time. So once you have activated it the first time, all the later times you have to reactivate the license if at all you want to perform any licensing operation. Then if you want to buy a rental license, configure existing license, login and as remote challenge user and work in educational mode. Now if you want to work in educational mode, that is without a license, the only restriction is that you cannot pass vouchers on all the days. That is, you will only be able to pass vouchers on the 1st, 2nd and the 31st of every month. So that is how you can work in educational mode. If you want to work in educational mode, you can click here and work in educational mode. So the other options we will see later, we will come to activate license. Now when you come to activate license, you have to enter your serial number, your activation key, email ID of administrator, that is the person who will be administering tally. So you have to be very careful not to give your email ID, because sometimes tally might want to send very important communication to customers. So the customer's address, email ID, and an account name. So account name is just for the identification of the customer's account. So I have a dummy serial number and activation key. So to show this demo, let us give the serial number and activation key. So you would also be having a serial number. You can give that. You can give the email ID of administrator. Given my serial number, I have given my activation key, I have given the admin email ID, and I have given an account name for easy identification. So you can see now that my license is activated, and now there is one additional step, that is Tally will send an email to my email ID, the admin email ID that I have given with an unlock key. Now I will need to enter that unlock key in Tally to completely activate the license. So say I press enter to continue, it will ask me for unlock key. Now let me go and get my unlock key here. So I have got a message, an email from Tally. I'm just going to enter that. So now my license is activated. So I've got this error message, this message. So this is a success message saying that my license is successfully activated. So this is all about license activation. I hope all of you will also able to do this. So like we saw licensing, we have activate license and working education mode. So when I activate it, I have to give my serial number and activation code, and thirdly unlock code. So this way my license was activated. I hope all of you were also able to do it. So let us start with actually working with Tally. That is, the first step is company. By company. Now, company is not when we refer it in terms of Tally. Company is what is just a unit for which you wish to manage your transactions. So, say you want to maintain your family account, you will create a company for that in Tally, and then you also have a partnership. So then you will create a different company in Tally. So a business entity is a company in Tally. So let us start with creation, okay? So we are going to create a company. So before we actually move to the product, let us first see our presentation. So that after I see the presentation, we can definitely add it in the product. So first, what is a company? Now this is already we have answered. A unit to which you want to allocate your account is called a company in size. Mandatory info. So you will see. Now let us move to the product. Now these are the mandatory info that are required while you are creating your company. That is company name, country, state, whether you are maintaining your books for accounts only or accounts with inventory, as your financial year starting and your books beginning from. So we will see them in detail. Let us go to the product. So for creating a company, I will go to create company. You can also use a shortcut of just pressing C on your keyboard. So these, the highlighted letters are the key instructions. So if you want to go to select company, you can press an S. If you want to create company, you can press a C. Now I will give a name. See, I give Acme Trader. This is my company name. I will give an address. I will give my country. I will select my state. I can specify my pin code, my other details. Okay. Then I can see whether I want to maintain only accounts or accounts with inventory. That is, you want to maintain only your accounting details or you also want to maintain your inventory details. So I, for now, we will concentrate only on accounts. So I will select it as account only. Now financial year from. So financial year from is, as per your country, what is your financial year starting? So in India, it is 1st April, right? So we will give that. And book beginning from. So say, this is generally the financial year from starting. But say you are starting your book in the middle of the financial year. So then say it is your starting your book from 1st May. Then you can give your book beginning from as 1st May. So for that we will give it as 1st April. Now these are the basic requirements for creating a company. That is, you have to give a name, you have to give your state, your country, your, you have to maintain accounts, whether it is only accounts or whether it is accounts with inventory. You can give your financial year from and book beginning from. So that is what we saw here. Yep. The mandatory info that we have to give. Now, we will start with ledgers and vouchers. So I hope all of you are clear with what is a company and how to create a company. And I hope you are all able to replicate this right now. Now you can see here accounting voucher creation on this screen. So what is a voucher? Now see, in the old days before tally came, right, we can see how accounting books were maintained. So say that we had to record a hotel bill. So what would be done was a printed sheet called a payment voucher was filled up and attached to the bill. This was then taken to the accounts person who would enter the transaction. So now, this is why the use of the word voucher, it is very common in India and that is why it is used in tally as well. So in other countries, we would call it a transaction. I just say up for this, a payment transaction. So now, in this screen, you see there are two accounts, that is traveling expenses and cash. So these are your accounting ledgers. I simply call it account. Now you can see here payment. So this is a payment voucher type. So for each type of transaction, there is a different voucher type. So for payment, there is a voucher type. Receipt, there is another voucher type. Like this. Now we will see how exactly we can maintain this. So how exactly we can maintain ledgers and how exactly we can maintain voucher in tally. So now we have moved to what is the legend about and how it appears. And what are the manageable things that you have to give it by creating a legend account? You have to give the name, and if you want, you can give an alias, and you have to give the group under it, which it is group. So let us move to Tanya now. So I will accept my company configuration, and my company is open now. So for creating a ledger, I will go to account info, ledger, create. Okay. So let us create a conveyance expense account. So alias, now if I want to give an alias, I can give it always. So alias is just for easy identification, or say another name for the ledger. So now my ledger name is conveyance expense. But for easy reference, I just want to refer to it as conveyance, C-O-N-V. So then I can give it. Now what Tally will do is, even if in any report you refer, you want to see what is C-O-N-D, what is the ledger report for C-O-N-D, then also it will show as conveyance expenses. So you can select the ledger as conveyance expenses or C-O-N-D. So the alias is just another name to identify your ledger account. So you have to group it. So you have to group it under a group in this expense form. So this is an expense and it is an indirect expense for me. So I will select indirect expenses as my group. So this is all that is required for you to create a ledger. And I hope all of you can replicate it now. So just create a ledger ledger, and this is the basic configuration for ledger creation. Alright, now let us move to the presentation. So like this, you can create your ledger. Now let us create some more ledger so that we can easily practice this. So conveyance already we have created under indirect expenses. Let us quickly create office rent account under indirect expenses. Okay. Next is salary under indirect expenses. Then sales under sales account. Then customer A under candidator. So as you can see, when I'm selecting the group, I'm only typing the first few letters, and Tally automatically filters the groups which have the letters. So since I want to select Sunday letter, I am just writing SU and Sunday letter is highlighted for me. That is how easy calculates it for sorting. Then customer B under Sunday letter. Then supplier A under Sunday creditor. Supplier B under Sundry creditor. Then State Bank of India under bank account with an opening balance of 125,000. So bank account and the opening balance is specified here. So I have to specify 125,000. So when I specify 125,000, Tally automatically takes it as debit, because its bank account generally have a debit balance. Next, cash account I have to alter. So I will go to alter and then I will select cash, because cash is already existing as a ledger in Tally. Cash, the cash in hand, and 25,000 in debit. Okay. So this way, I have created all the ledgers that I have to create, and I hope all of you were able to do it as simply as I was. Let us move to creating the first voucher. So we will create a payment for conveyance expenses. So first of all, we have to go to the voucher type, which is a payment voucher type. Second, we have to select the conveyance account. Okay, and so now we will move to the product, and let us pass a voucher. So for passing a voucher, I have to go to accounting voucher and F5, that is, I'm already on the payment voucher. On the right side, you can see the shortcut key. If you click on F5 payment, also it goes, or if you click F5 from your keyboard, then also it will take you to payment. If you want to pass a receipt, you have to go to F6 receipt, or otherwise you can click F6. So in this way, now we will pass a voucher. Let us go back to the presentation and see the voucher that we have to pass, which is payment for conveyance expenses. Right? So I will say, see, I'm paying to cab, and I will select my conveyance expenses, and I can give any amount. In this way, I have passed the voucher. Let us see the voucher that I have passed. Okay, so my date was already available, which was 1st April. Now, say if you want to change the date, let us go to, you have to click F2. Okay, so say I want to change the date to 1st May. I can give it as 1-5, tally accepted. I can give it as 1st May, tally accepted, and take it as 1st May. I can also give it as, say, 1.5.14, tally again, take it as 1st May. So this is the flexibility with which you can give your date. You can give the date in whichever manner you are comfortable, tally, so take it in the same way. Next, I have selected that I am paying it to cash. And I have selected my convenience expenses here, so I have given my amount. Now, if you are very conversant with accounts, then you would want to specify the debit and credit of this ledger, and you would want to pass this voucher in debit and credit. So that you can press F12. You can, now this mode of voucher entry that we were using right now is single entry mode. In this, the debit and credit are already identified. But if you yourself want to identify it, you can say use single entry mode for payment, receipt or voucher as load, and now let us see this. So you can see 2 and buy. So buy convenience expenses 10,000 and 2 cash. So it is just the presentation. The same voucher can be passed either in single entry mode or double entry mode. So I hope all of you are replicating the same thing and are able to understand how you can pass the voucher. So now let us move to the slide. Now, voucher, single and double entry mode. That is what we just saw. It is single entry mode. Debit and credit are already identified by Tani. And if you do not want this, you can pass the vouchers in double entry mode by clicking on F12 and saying no to use single entry mode. Now, in the same way now, let us pass a few more vouchers so that we can get a hang of this now. Okay, so let us pass a purchase from supplier A for 80,000. So for purchase, I will click on F9 purchase. Now you can see it is in 2 and buy mode, but I want to pass my vouchers quickly, so I will select it as invoice mode, where my debit and credit are already fixed. So supplier invoice number you can give, supplier date you can give, passing, so it is supplier A. I will select my supplier A. Yes. It is a purchase. So I have to select my purchase ledger. First, I do not have a purchase ledger created. So do I have to go back and create the ledger and then come back and pass the voucher? No. I can just press Alt T, that is Alt button and T button together with in this voucher and in this sheet, and you can see it automatically takes me to ledger creation. Now I will create a ledger called purchase and a purchase account. As you can see, from the same voucher, while I was doing voucher entry also, I can create the ledger that I require. So for 80,000 amount, I will give a narration, that is 1000 kg of discount. I will like this, I have passed my purchase order. Now I will pass the sale to supplier B. So I will go to SA sales, supplier B, party. I can ignore this discard details screen for now. Then I will select my sales letter and then 45,000 amount and there is in the 500 kg of discard. Now I am paying by cash, printing as statement of 1000 rupees. So I will go to payment. Again I will select use single entry mode here. Now I will select cash because I am paying by cash and I am paying printing and stationery. Again I do not have printing and stationery here, so I will select all three. Indirect expenses and I am paying an amount of 1250. I will give my narration, which is purchase, office price, and then I am passing a contra entry from the State Bank of India with cash account of 25,000, that is a cash withdrawal. So I will go to contra voucher. Contra is where both cash and bank are involved. So I am withdrawing cash from the State Bank of India. Amount is 25,000. So it is showing me negative cash because I have already passed voucher with cash. So denomination I am giving. So why this shows me as negative cash is because this transaction which I was passing was a cash deposit. But we have to pass a cash withdrawal voucher. What I will do is I will just exchange this letter. This transaction. Now you can see. Then I have passed the contra voucher. So in this way, I hope you were all able to pass the voucher. We will just take a short break while you can just go through whatever we have covered, and then we will start with the next part of the session. Welcome back, and I hope you are all able to analyze and understand the features of installation, of launching tally, company creation, ledger creation, voucher creation, and then voucher. And finally, you saw voucher creator voucher. Right? So now let us go to a feature called bill by bill tracking. Now say, we will take it with the help of an example. Now say you have lent some money to a friend. Say 1000 rupees and a week later he borrows 500 rupees more and then he pays you 400 rupees. So how will you record it in real life? So the answer will be that he owes you 1100 rupees, right? Now when he pays you the 400, will you ask him against which borrowing is he paying? Is he paying against the 1000 rupees or the 500 rupees? No, right? You will not see. You just want to know total how much he has paid you and how much is remaining. And this is called as all account balancing. But say in business, this is normally not the way how you will track your goods, right? So say you sell goods to a customer for 1000 rupees and later again you sell for 500 rupees and then when he pays you 400 rupees, he will always specify for which sale he is paying you the 400 rupees. So say he is paying you for the second bill, say for 500 rupees. Okay, so the first bill might, you know, you have given him a longer credit or something. So which is why he is paying you for the second bill. So you will have to track those kind of bills. Okay, so that is the scenario in which bill by bill tracking is important. So we will see how we can use this as stamina. So there are two verbs, that is on account, then only the total figure remaining is known, and bill by bill. There is transaction level balance is known. So how to do it is, you have to go to the ledger and you have to enable maintain balances bill by bill. That is actually move to tally and do it. So I am going to maintain bill by bill, pay for customer A and supplier A. So I will go to accounts info, ledger, alter, supplier A, and I will say maintain balances bill by bill as yes. Now I can also give a credit period, say of 30 days. So after 30 days only, each bill will be due. Okay, and one thing also to notice, you can also give a credit limit. That is, you can also specify that, say, 45,000 is the limit of credit that you want to give to this supplier. So in that case, you will need to enable credit limit, which we will come to later. Okay, now let's go to customer A. Again, customer A. I want to maintain balances bill by bill, and again I'm giving a credit period of 30 days. That is, I also have a credit period of 30 days to pay my customer. Okay? I hope all of you are doing this and you are successful in configuring the network of bill by bill tracking. Let us move to the presentation. Now let us pass some transactions to understand how this works. So I am going to pass a purchase from supplier A for 45,000. So for accounting voucher, purchase S9. So as invoice. So as supplier A is a party. It's a purchase. For 45,000, bill reference is 734. Now, when you are passing a voucher, by default, tally will automatically give a bill reference based on the voucher number. But if you want to give your own bill reference, say in this, there is a bill reference of 734. That is not the voucher number, right? So I will go to S2. There is an option here. Use default for bill allocation. I will make it no. Now let us see how it works. So now I get the bill by details field. And I will select the new reference because it is a new bill and my reference is 734. So I will see the bill reference to 734. Due date as we have specified in the ledger, 30 days and 45,000 is the amount. Okay. Okay, so for credit day, it was 15 for this voucher. If you want to go to a previous voucher that you have passed, you just have to press page up from the keyboard. So this is my previous voucher, and I will change the credit period to 15 days. And there is a narration also, which is 100 kg of banana. Okay. Now, purchase again from supplier A for 30,000. Reference is 775 this time. Due date is 30 days and 100 kg price day. Right. Next is payment. So I am now paying to the supplier. So I will go to payment. I am paying by cash. 40,000 to supplier A. So it will ask me again with bill. So it is again 734 bill. I am paying 25,000. So again check this 734 bill. I am paying 25,000. So actually I am paying 25,000. And again, this is the 732. Next, I am making a payment to supplier A of 40,000. payments to supplier A of 40,000 now. Let us see. It is 20,000 and again 734 payments. Calculate against reference 734 20,000. Then against reference with bill 775 of 20,000. Then I am receiving money. That is, I am receiving in advance from customer A in cash. So receipt is as this. In cash, customer A, 15,000. So it is an advance. So I will select type of bill as advance. Bill reference is also advance. So I will select it as, I will specify this bill reference as advance. I will pass my order. Now, sale to customer. Now I am passing the sale to customer A. Of 20,000. See this? It's a new reference of 1234 and 15,000 from advance. So first we select against reference of advance. So it is 15,000 against the advance bill and new reference of 1234 of 5,000. So you can see in the bottom screen also, against reference 15,000 and new reference 5,000. Yes? So in this case, we have maintained this by bill tracking for these bills. I hope all of you were able to do it. And you were able to give the bill reference and select against reference to specify against which bill it is being tracked. So we'll start with which the date of last entry, and then in your system, the date that shows in your system. So in your system, when you see in the bottom panel, you will see a system date, right? So what do these dates mean? You have to have an understanding of that. And even now, when you are on the product and you are seeing your tally, you can see the same thing, right? Your current period, your current date, date of last entry, and your system date. Now, how are they relevant in tally, and what is the functionality of each of them? So, let's start with current period. Now, current period is the current financial year that you have selected in your data. So, if you do want to change your current period, you have to press Alt F2 from tally. Let's move to tally to see this. So, I will press Alt F2 and I can change the period. So I can give any period. It does not necessarily have to be my financial year. It is just what you give as a period, and tally will generate all your reports and show you all the default data based on the period that you select here. So from here you can change your current period. Now, current date. What is the current date? Current date is the date again that you set in tally. So if you want to change your current date, you can go to F2 date. So Alt F2 period is to change the period. F2 is to change the current date. So if you change the current date from here, tally will take the current date of entry as this date. So whichever transaction say you are going to pass, or say you are going to view a report, tally will take by default the current date as whatever date you feed it here. Now, what is the date of last entry? Now here if you see, the date of last entry is 30th November 2014. So what is this date of last entry? And in your data, it will be the respective date of last entry. What is it? That is just the last date when you have passed the transaction. So this is to show that this is the last date of entry. Now this cannot be changed because it is taken automatically as per the entry that you do. Then next is system date. Now system date you can see and on the bottom of your screen. Now tally will not change the current date as per your system date. Now system date is there in your system. So what happens is if tally starts changing the current date as per your system date, what happens is many times you would have kept data entry of your previous date to this date, to today. So what happens is if Sally changes the data automatically, you will not be able to pass transactions, which is why we have given the flexibility that you can set your own date, which means that you can pass your transactions as per the date you want to set. Sally will not automatically set it as per your system date. So I hope you all can see this in your Tally and understand what is the relevance and what is the meaning of each of these different days in your Tally. Let us move. So now the next essential financial reporting. Now we have passed few transactions. So now we are going to see the some basic financial reports that obviously are very relevant to a customer. So first we'll see what is a day book, then we'll see cash or bank book, then we'll see accounts receivable with aging analysis, then we'll see accounts payable with aging analysis, and then we will see overdue receivables and payables. So basically what you need to understand now are these are the some essential financial reports which we have in Tally, and we will now go in detail into each report. Right. So the first report, which is the day book. Now, what is the day book and how can we move to this in Tally? So day book is just the list of transactions that you have passed as on a day. Of course, you can change the date, you can change the period, but it is just a list of transactions. So, at one part, you can see what are the transactions that you have passed in a particular case. So, to show these reports, we require a lot of transactions so that you can understand the relevance of it, which is why I will now move to a sample data in which we have a lot of transactions. So, we can understand this report much clearly, but you can see this in your own data with whatever transactions you have passed till now. Okay? To move to day book, you have to go to display. Day book. So now as on 1st April, I have only one transaction, right? Now you can always change the period. Say I give it as 1st April 2012 to say current date. So again, that is just one transaction, which means that from 2012 in this period that I have given of 2012 to 2015, there is only one transaction that I have passed. I can again change the period, say 1/4/2010. So I want to go from 2010 to 31st March 2015. What are the transactions that I have passed? So it seems there are a lot of transactions, which is why Tally and Nagel now show me all the transactions that I have passed. Now you can see there are about 1300 transactions in this data. So now let me take one date. Okay, so I will take this 1/4/2010. So these are all the transactions that I have passed as of 1st April. So this is basically just a list of transactions that you have passed. Now if you want to see more details of these transactions, you can press Alt F1 here, Alt F1 details. So it will show me the details of the transaction. If you want to view it in condensed form, condense it. You can change the period from Alt F2, change the date from F2. Now, if you want to view transactions of only one particular voucher type, so you only want to view your payment as on this day, you can go to F4, change voucher, select payment, and as Tally will show you only the payment voucher that have been passed as of that date. Okay? Then you can view a columnar report showing you details of each and every aspect of the transaction. And the important thing is now you can also filter for few transactions. So as a business owner, what you might want to just see particular transactions, right? So now let us see what is given in this presentation. Now we have filtered for payment vouchers having amount more than 15,000. So what this business owner wants is they want to see a voucher, that is a payment voucher with amount more than 15,000. So So say you are not able to recollect, but you know that there is a payment voucher more than 15,000. So let us go back to the day book. So I will give a date of 2010 because we have transaction data on 2010. Okay, now I will filter. So for filtering, I have to go to Alt F12 green. Now I will filter for voucher, having voucher type with name containing payment. Now you all can also do it with this so that you all can see what exactly will be derived from this filter. And I will say end of list and then add voucher having ledger amount greater than 15,000. Okay? Now let us see what tally will show me. So you can see now tally has given me that there is one payment transaction with amount more than 15,000. In this way, you can easily filter for what information you are looking for. Right? So this is all about Daybook. Now you can explore in detail more about Daybook to understand exactly how it looks and what are the features in it. Let us move to the next report. So next is cash and bank book. Now every business owner would like to know where their cash and bank books lie, right, at any point in time. So let us see how we can see this in Tally. Now in Tally, the important and the most wonderful feature is that you only have to pass your transactions. All your other reports are automatically shown to you on the basis of the transactions that you have passed. So we will now move to how to see your cash and bank books in Tally. So we have moved back to Gateway of Tally. Now to go to see the cash and bank books, go to Display. Account books and cash or bank books. So now you can see what is your current position of cash, what is the current position of your bank account, and all your cash and bank account. So from one screen you can see what is your current position as far as your cash and bank accounts are concerned. So I hope you all are also able to see your, as per your transactions, what is the position of cash and your bank book. Here also, whenever, whatever period you require, you can change it as per your requirement. Okay? Now let us see what is the next report. I hope all of you are clear about cash and bank books and how it appears. Next is your accounts receivable. Now, you will always want to see what is the amount that you have to receive as on any particular day so that you can keep a track of it and contact the person from whom you want to receive your amount, right? Let us move to Tally and see this. So to go to accounts receivable, if you go to Display, Statements of Accounts, Outstanding and Receivable. So I will take all items And now you can see, so my period is 1st April 2010 to 31st March 2011. Now it shows me all my bills receivables, which means it shows me when it was due and by how many days it is overdue. So on this basis, you can always keep a track, continuous track of which are the bills that you still have to receive. And which you have already received. So I hope all of you are able to see this, your bills receivable in your data. Okay, now let us move back. So in this way, Sally will show you all your bills receivable as per the period that you define. Next is receivable aging. Now how do you see how much amount is receivable and can you get the aging? That is, you want to specify different periods. So say, so from 0 to 30 days, I want to see how many of my bills are aging. And how many are aging from 30 to 60, 60 to 90? That way you can filter and take quick action on the ones which are aging the most. So to get that kind of a report, from bills outstanding, you can press F6, age-wise. And here you can select whether you want to age by the bill date or you want to age by the due date. So as per what you select. So say I select aging by due date. Now you can set your aging period. So now I have set it as 0 to 30, 30 to 60, 60 to 90. You can set it as you want, and the next time that you open this report, Sally will automatically take the aging that you have defined. So like this, I have set my aging. Now let us see my report of this receivable. So now, Sally has shown me that almost all my bills are aging more than 180 days as of 31st March 2011. So in this way, you can do this in your own data and find out what is the aging of all your bills and which bills require priority action as compared to others. Next is accounts payable and the aging analysis. Now, accounts payable, let us move and see it. So for accounts payable, same thing, from display, statements of accounts, outstanding, payable. And this shows me all that payable. So now you all can see and do a demo of your payables in your data. And we will also see the aging analysis. So please do that also in your data. So this is your payables. So how much you owe and what is the aging of that. So to see the aging, you can press F6, age-wise. Again, you can select your aging method. So say this time I will select aging by bill date. I have given my aging period accordingly, and now I will see my report of what is the aging and how my bills exactly they are aging. So I hope all of you are also seeing it in your data. and you have an understanding of how to do this and what information you will get from this. Next is overdue. Now, how do you see only the bills that are overdue and which are receivables and overdue payables? So, to see that from month report, you can go to display, exception report, and overdue receivables. So, now Tally will show me all my bills that are overdue and what is the overdue, how many days by which it is overdue. Similarly, if you want to see overdue payables, you can go to overdue payables and Tally will show me by how many days these bills are overdue. So we have come to the end of this section, and this was just the basic essentials of starting and implementing Tally ERP 9 in a company. So we saw how to install Tally, how to activate the license, how to create a company, voucher creation, ledger accounts, bill by bill tracking, and financial reporting. So I hope this session was very clear to all of you and you were able to understand what are the capabilities, what is the feature, and what are the benefits of all of these features. I thank you for attending this session and have a nice day.